Good evening, everybody. Have you ever wondered about those beautiful murals in the Point neighborhood of Salem? They are the work of artists engaged by Salem's Punto Urban Art Museum, a mission-driven social justice art program created by the North Shore Community Development Coalition starting in 2017. This nationally recognized public art program features more than 85 large-scale murals by 75 international and local artists, several of whom are joining us here tonight to talk about their work. Our host this evening, David Valecillos, is one of Punto Urban Museum's founders. An award-winning urban planner and real estate developer, David oversees all urban planning projects for the NSCDC, which includes developing multi-million dollar and multi-site projects, as well as managing the arts and design initiatives. David holds a master's in city planning from Boston University, where he is also an adjunct professor. He currently serves on the Urban Land Institute Boston Chapter Real Estate Committee and Cambridge's Public Art Commission. Tonight, he will be in conversation with several of the Point muralists and will lead us in a deeper exploration of the murals, the artists themselves, their inspirations, and the impact of the project in the community. David, thanks so much for joining us here tonight. The mic is all yours.
Joyce, thank you so much for having me. I think I can speak on behalf of the artists, but we're thrilled to be here. And we'll talk about all of them a little later. I'm gonna share my screen to talk a little bit about the call for art that we did in our program. And then we'll dive more into the beautiful art that the artists did. So, that said, just to confirm that people can see the screen, I feel the artist can just give me a little bit of sign. Yes, thank you. All right. So today we're here to talk about our exhibition called What Does It Mean to Be Free? It's located on Peabody Street in the Point neighborhood in Salem. But before that, I wanted to thank Mass Development, who is a quasi-governmental organization in the state, but has helped us support, do this exhibition. Before we dive into the exhibition itself, as Joyce mentioned, the Punto Urban Art Museum was founded by North Shore Community Development Coalition and several other staff members in 2017. And before we dive into the Punto Urban Art Museum, North Shore CDC's mission is to invest in neighborhoods to create thriving communities. We actually work across the North Shore of Massachusetts. We do affordable housing, we do youth development, arts and placemaking, and community engagement. As we work across the North Shore, we are actually based in the Point neighborhood. We're based in Salem, and we do what we call our neighborhood model in the Point neighborhood in Salem, like where all our programs come together. As you might know, because a lot of you are familiar with Salem, the Point neighborhood is maybe a couple blocks away from Salem's vibrant downtown. When we started working in this neighborhood in 2011 as our merged organization called North Shore CDC or North Shore Community Development Coalition, We selected this neighborhood because the previous organization had been working there and owned some real estate there, but also because of the rich immigrant history that it had. The Point neighborhood has always kind of been a gateway for immigrant communities. Back in early 1900s, it hosted working class French Canadian community. 100 years later, the demographics are kind of the same, but mostly Hispanic and as immigrant and working class communities, there has been disfranchised from the rest of the city. And so when we put a vision and action plan with the community in 2013, we kind of guide the goals of what we wanted to see in this community. And among the many goals, it was the improvement of housing quality and affordability, the improvement of parks and public spaces. And there was one that it was really brought up by people inside the neighborhood and outside of the neighborhood, but it was the stigmatization of the place of the neighborhood as an area. And while we did many improvements throughout the last 8 years in housing, for example, we rehabilitated, we have rehabilitated 200 units, mostly historic properties. You can see some of them on these pictures. We actually opened a little community park, the basketball court that you see. We opened some interesting program spaces and incubators. We helped the city rehabilitate 3 of the 4 parks that are in the area. This is the community space that some of you might know, Spacio. We run a bunch of programming from there. We actually founded what's called now Youth Build, our Youth Build chapter, North Shore chapter, national recognized right now. We opened a youth housing that helps support youth between the ages of 18 and 24 years old. We opened a retail incubator that we actually just opened before the pandemic. We had about 2 small businesses where we offer free space for them to test their concept. And now this year is actually starting to open. It's going to feature 7 or 5 new businesses in the next 12 months. So we're very thrilled about that. It's on Lafayette Street. But as we were doing all that work, it was interesting for us to see that kind of like divide between the immigrant neighborhood and the rest of Salem was still very prominent. So we found ourselves in 2015 doing a famous word, the placemaking kind of like intervention of painting 2 crosswalks. And we said, why don't we paint the ones that no one wants to cross or that kind of like bridges those 2 communities. So we decided to paint the one on Dutch Street right here and the one on Peabody Street, and we put music and food, and we realized at that moment the power of art and what art can do to bring communities together. Because as we were doing that, we saw residents of downtown or people that work in downtown interacting with the Hispanic community, and no one was really paying attention of where people were coming from. They were just mostly focused on the art. So that's when we saw the potential of what public art can do for communities and how it can serve as a platform to talk about those things. So that was kind of like the long, short story of how the Punto Urban Art Museum came to be. As we were developing the concept, we thought that we wanted to not only create a public art program, but we wanted to make sure that it had a mission that was focused on social justice. So as the main goal is to break down the invisible socioeconomic barriers between the Point neighborhood and the rest of Salem. But at the same time, we wanna infuse pride of place. We wanted to make sure that the local businesses of the Point neighborhood will benefit. And at the same time, we wanted to use this as a platform for social justice, to talk about social justice issues. And this is why we're very excited about the exhibition that we're gonna talk about today. So what does it mean to be free? Inspired by Nina Simone, actually, because of the horrible acts against the African-American community last year, the killing of George Floyd, we really felt that we needed to do a call for action. So we call upon Massachusetts-based artists to get inspired by this song by Nina Simone, I Wish I Knew How Would It Feel to Be Free. And we asked them to either play a homage to her or the authors of the song, but at the same time, make a representation of what does it mean to be free for them. So we're gonna show a little bit of a video. And we're lucky enough to have 4 of the artists that painted on this exhibition. They're going to share a little bit of their story. I'm going to ask each one of them to share a little bit of their background and then the inspiration behind their piece as I show pictures of their work. So with that, I'm going to introduce the exhibition with a little video. Let's see. And I'm actually not sure. Can people hear the music? Yes. Okay, great.
This project, I think it means everything. So it's wonderful that the Urban Art Museum is taking the lead on not just saying like, okay, we're going to tell your stories, giving the microphone aside and saying, tell your own story. I think that means everything.
So we were asked to kind of think of what the idea of freedom is to us. And it's interesting because while I'm here today, my 3rd graders, I've taken a picture of the wall. and they're designing their own murals at school today about what they think freedom is. So I'm really excited and interested to see what they think.
I think the Urban Art Museum is doing something that we don't really get to see in our communities. This project is really great because it's bringing together 20 artists to think about themselves and to really begin to ponder what freedom means to them as well.
Freedom is really being who you are and being comfortable in those shoes, but also being cognizant about creating a culture and a community in which other people feel comfortable being themselves. So it's not just about my own comfort, but it's about working to make other people comfortable as well.
We all have the merit to, you know, look out for each other and be helpful. But I think kindness is, I think, very important in today's world right now. If we can do that through art, if we can do that through making a representation of, you know, showing support, you know, then growth for, you know, a more diverse, a more, you know, sustainable community within. So I think that's what this project entails for me.
It's to be able to walk freely among my community and within this nation without fear of someone else holding authority over me, to just live life within my own power unapologetically.
Freedom draws on the story and the struggle of my ancestors, of the people who've come before me. And when I think about what freedom can look like, I think of the most oppressed people in this country and the world really rising up and struggling together to create a society that prioritizes the needs and the well-being of the people.
It's being able to do something and not worry, whether it's lead your life, do your job, have a relationship, ask questions, have conversation with people, just living your life without fear.
As we have four of them today, I also wanted to recognize the other 16 that were not here, but we're honored to have all of them have works of art being shown on Peabody Street. We really focus on diversity and we wanted to highlight multiple and diverse backgrounds. So here's kind of like a collection of the 20 murals that you can witness in Peabody Street as you walk along. From Lafayette to Congress Street. And today we're lucky to have, like I said, four of them. I'm gonna allow each one of them to give a little of an introduction, but Anna, I know you're based in Salem. Ambrosia is based in Boston. Jacob, I believe you're based in Salem, but correct me if I'm wrong. And then Naija, I know that you're based in Salem, but in Boston. But why don't each one of you introduce yourself briefly, and then I will start with Jacob talking about his work, but I will stop sharing so that everyone can see your faces, and then please. I will say, Jacob, you go first.
Hey everyone, I'm Jake Jinga. I kind of go by the name Maker Jake as an artist. I'm an artist and an educator. I actually live in Norton, Mass. But I'm kind of more from the New Bedford area when I was creating this mural.
Ambrosia?
Sorry, I had to unmute myself. My name is Ambrosia. I am based out of Boston. I'm currently living in Dedham, Mass.
All right. And Anna?
I'm Anna Dugan. I also go by Anna Did a Thing. I'm a mural artist based in Salem, Mass. Kind of more on the North Shore, because I technically have a studio now in Lynn. But yeah. Also, I just want to say, if at any point I'm unmuted and you guys hear a dog barking, I'm so sorry. My dog is very needy.
Naija.
Hi, my name is Nyjah, and I am a Black non-binary artist from Boston, Massachusetts, and I mainly do murals, mixed media, and digital work.
Great, thank you, all of you. So I'm gonna go back and share my screen, and I'm gonna start with Jake. If you can please introduce your beautiful work. And then I will ask you to also please share a little bit of the activities that you did with your students. I actually got to upload the picture, so you'll have them later on the third slide.
Awesome, sweet. So as I mentioned before, I am an educator. Currently, I teach kindergarten through fifth grade in a small town outside of Boston. Right now, that's all remote, so teaching kindergartners online this year has been a trip. But this is my mural design. Now, I come from a very, very engaged Native American family. My grandfather was the chief of the American Indian Federation. My family has helped start local tribes. We have very few federally recognized tribes in New England. So a lot smaller localized tribes in the Rehoboth and Attleboro areas in Massachusetts. They've actually traveled all through Canada and taught dance back to indigenous tribes in Canada that had lost those kinds of traditions. So extremely, extremely involved, organized powwows, done school things. But what's always been interesting for me as an individual is being the only child of the youngest family member. I kind of fell away from that a little bit as I was growing up. And when you tell people that you're Native American, especially when you don't present as what people think Native Americans look like, it becomes awkward because the first thing they ask is like, oh, what tribe? And it's like, well, my family isn't tribally affiliated right now, right? We're not a member of an organized tribe at the moment. But that doesn't fit into the understanding of Native Americans and tribes for colonial thinkers. So this mural's goal was to basically say, you know, creating that space where I can feel comfortable being who I am and engaging in my culture without fitting the needs and standards of people outside my culture. So my family calls me Yellow Eagle, yellow to represent the sun as the teacher. And again, with the eagle is the teacher that brings the messages from the maker to everyone down on earth. So that was a family name given to me. So in some ways, this is a self-portrait. But it's essentially an eagle flying up above storm clouds. Now, as an educator, I did teach a lesson with all of my grade levels do mural designs. But this year I engaged with the high school students, advanced art students, so actually freshmen through seniors, depending on where they were with their art. And I actually gave them the same prompt that that the Punto Urban Art Museum gave me, right? What's that idea of freedom? What does it mean to you? How can you express it? And I was really fascinated to see the vast differences in the students. So we actually ended up with 20 students painting 20 different murals in an underpass in Weston, Mass. It's on a bike trail that cuts right through the town I teach in. Now, we had originally had this grand idea of creating a single mural that had all of their designs connected, right? One person had an eagle and that eagle coming into a koi fish and then so on and so on. But after having conversations with the students, everyone's understandings and desires about freedom were so different and independent. I felt like it didn't do them justice by connecting them. So we broke them down into frames the same way we did ours with the museum. So it's been a really fascinating adventure, especially with like the vast span in technical skills. This is after about 2 days of painting. And that's, they're gonna be done hopefully, we'll see, next couple weekends. And you'll be able to visit them, they're public, and you'll actually be able to scan a QR code and read all about what the students were trying to say and express.
Great. Thank you so much for sharing, Jacob.
No problem.
We're so excited to see that you took the the challenge of expressing such a complex topic with your students. And I think that was one of our goals as we were putting this call for art out. We were even, at the beginning, we were thought of challenging you practitioners to actually have conversations within your community about what freedom means. And I think you took that and you carry it forward. So that's awesome. All right, well, next we have Ambrosia. So I will leave the floor to you to walk us through the inspiration behind your mural and your story. So please.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ambrosia. I am a mom. I am an artist, a visual artist, like I said, based out of Boston, Mass. I started painting about 6 years ago. I've always been kind of a creative. I started painting and kind of putting things on social media, and it kind of took off, which is a blessing. I've been featured in a lot of different publications. I've been blessed to work with a lot of different companies for a lot of different projects. A lot of my work surrounds feminism and just, I guess, women empowerment, sisterhood between women, and also freedom on different levels in different bases. Within women and people of color as well. This mural basically to me just symbolizes a young Black girl, kind of a reflection of myself, also my daughter and other women that I know and try to represent within my work as well. I think that a lot of us don't realize the freedom that we have or the capabilities that we have regarding freedom. So her wings on the back of her kind of reflected the fact that, you know, she has these golden wings and the ability to fly and have certain levels of freedom. She doesn't know it yet. So I think that the middle piece of not being free or not feeling free to being and feeling free, the middle ground of getting there is really important to me. My work is very abstract and freehand and not so, I guess, visually perfect all the time, but I think that is what makes it really beautiful in my opinion. So I kind of wanted to reflect the idea of basically what the song and the assignment meant to me with this. So yeah.
Great, thank you so much, Maria, for telling your story. I'm sure we will follow up with questions after everyone says so. So Naija, the floor is yours now.
Hi, so sorry, I am kind of getting updates about something a little important. So I do apologize if I've been a little bit absent-minded. But my name is Naija. Again, I've already introduced that I am a multimedia artist. At least with this piece, I kind of just want to jump right into it, but it was inspired by my grandmother. So when I listened to the song by Nina Simone, the first thing I thought about was my grandma because she is a fan of Nina Simone. At least when I was listening to the song, at first was thinking kind of what a space of freedom would be for my grandma. And I just thought about the fact that she works a lot of hours. She usually is working 60 hours a week and has been doing that since she was 16 years old at Boston Medical. And she is definitely a woman who can't take a vacation, is not able to take a break or anything. So I kind of wanted to challenge the idea of working to live, living to work by having her in her safe space, free from the stresses of the cycle of having to provide for a family and to work to survive. I also just kind of had her in a space of abstraction with animals because she's a big animal lover. And to be honest, I felt like having her shown in this way really kind of captured at least the emotion that I was feeling in the song. And usually I'm a very emotional driven artist and drive a lot of my inspiration from that. And yeah, I got to show my grandma too. And I don't know if you have the video, but I could probably pull it up on Instagram, but it was a pretty emotional moment.
Yeah, tell us a little more about that. Like, I mean, what was the conversation? Like, I mean, of course, feel free to share as much as you want. But
Sure. I mean,
what was that process like about the inspiration and then knowing that, yeah, you use her as a source of inspiration for the art and...
Oh, yeah. I mean, the process, it was just me kind of like first starting from the idea and just kind of creating it. And like, also just kind of learning more about my grandma. Like, I already know a lot about her, but like, definitely kind of doing more deep diving and kind of also this aspect of connecting with our elders and also respecting our elders and uplifting our elders is definitely a big part of it as well. And I will say, when I got to show her, she was very surprised because she had no idea. We just brought her to Salem and just brought her to it with no kind of warning. And I thought that was also a beauty of at least what I would hope could transition that emotion to other people also viewing it, or at least that connection also being felt.
Very nice. Thank you so much for sharing. All right, and last but not least, we have Anna Tugan, so please.
Hi, Nigel, I just wanna say I did see that video and it made me cry. It was so beautiful. So my piece was also inspired by specifically a family member, my tita Mercedes. I'm a Filipino-American artist, and I do a lot of work based off of my identity as a mixed race person that has grown up in the States, as a white presenting person of color, as a white presenting Filipina. There's a lot of complexities within all of our identities that I like to dive into. But when I saw the prompt, I specifically thought of a conversation that I had with my aunt, very close to the time of seeing the prompt. And it was her telling me her story of the story of her life coming to the United States. She came here for college, meeting, the person who had become her husband. And we had a really great conversation about that history, and something that had really like stuck out for me. Her marriage did not work out. And part of that, I felt when she was telling me the story of the beginning of this relationship, it felt like a story that I've heard a million times from a lot of different, particularly Asian women, particularly Filipino women, but it felt very predatory on the part of a white man seeing this exotic woman across the room and immediately thinking, that's who I want. And at first, sometimes some people may think, wow, that's so romantic. It's like, you know, love at first sight. But for someone who has grown up in this world of exotization and fetishizing of Asian women, it's a very uncomfortable thing. It's a very uncomfortable story to hear for me. So when I was thinking about this prompt, I was thinking about all the Filipino women, the women in my family who have ever felt exoticized. Because I grew up with, you know, I am white presenting, but a lot of times my identity has always been like, oh, like you're not full white though. Like, oh no, I knew it. And I, you know, I've had a lot of fetishizing of myself once people find out I'm Asian. It's a very strange and uncomfortable thing. But a lot of people think that being called exotic, whether that be me or my mother or my aunt or my sister or my cousins, is a good thing. They think, oh, wow, what a compliment to get. You're so exotic. But when I think of you're so exotic, I think, what are other things we call exotic? Animals at the zoo. And I think of, you know, the idea of being caged and the idea of someone wanting to possess you because you are other. Wanting to possess you because you are like a trophy look at how exotic my wife is. Look at how exotic my family is. And not every relationship, not every person is that way, but there it happens so often that I wanted to take this prompt and create this image that is based off of somewhere between a younger version of my aunt and a more modern Filipina with maybe some traditional tattoos. And I wanted to represent her among her fellow exotic creatures, free from cages, free from the gaze of these men, free from the feeling of possession. So I wanted to have her standing tall, standing proud, in her almost like reclaiming of her exotization. So that is where this came from.
Thank you so much for sharing, Anna. Such a powerful story and inspiration behind this beautiful piece. With that, I think we kind of have come up close of the informational session of tonight, introducing the pieces and the art. I believe we have a hard stop at 8, but we do have 15 minutes of Q&A. I can think of a few questions that I would love to ask the artist, but I will open it up to see if Caroline or Joyce, there are some questions from the audience that we want to open up. So Joyce or Caroline.
Oh, hey there.
Hi.
Hello. Are there any questions from the audience that we want to make?
No audience questions yet.
Okay.
But can you hear me?
Yes. We can hear you. Yes.
All right. I think you need to start my video, Carolyn.
Okay.
It's telling it's me. Not... In any case, I do have some. Here we go. I do have.
Okay. They're starting to come in now.
All right, they're starting to come in. And I have some questions of my own. One is, and this is one that I think any of the artists could respond to, and that is, what kinds of reactions have you gotten from the community in which you made your art? Whether that's people that you know or people that you didn't know before. So I'm just curious. I can't imagine that there was negative feedback, but I'm just wondering what kind of feelings it raised and how people express that to you when they see your art. Anybody?
I know on my end, I've had overwhelmingly positive feedback. I know from my own community, from the Filipino community, from the Asian community, I have gotten a lot of responses of empowerment, of positivity and a spark of discussion, which has been really nice. That's always, I feel like, one of the more gratifying parts of public art, is that it creates conversations in spaces that maybe some people, I know that I didn't grow up going to museums. My parents were not artsy people. They were not like, let me bring my kid to the museum today. That wasn't the case. So I love that people can walk down the street and there's art available to them that sparks thinking and sparks conversation. So I've had a few people message me saying, hey, this actually, walking down the entire strip, it was so nice because you got to stop at each one and really think about and discuss, what did this artist want to say about what it meant to them to be free? So it has been overwhelmingly positive on my end, at least.
Thank you. Any of you other artists?
I got a pretty great response. While I was doing the mural, I live really far away from the area. So I was engaging with people in different communities, and they were, I don't know, I feel like everybody else probably had the same experience, just people kind of in passing and just even seeing the process, not even like the finished products. They were really just excited to see something. Like to some people, it seems very like, oh,
you guys are painting on the walls or on the street. Like, it was exciting. It sparked a lot of conversation. And I think that just like in the time that we're in right now, just like with the pandemic and the, you know, just racial issues and just so many different levels of issues socially that we have, I think that human interaction and just like interacting with people who you have never met, you've never seen, like obviously that happens on a daily basis, but just having that conversation regarding art was really special to me. It was pretty pretty cool to see. So that was kind of like a big one for me.
So Ambrosia, I'm going to ask you a follow-on question because you mentioned process. And one of the questions we have here is, what is the process of taking your concept from, I think what we're guessing would be some kind of small concept rendering and taking it, you know, up to the scale of a wall? How does that unfold for you?
So I do everything kind of freehand. I'm completely self-taught. So art for me, I'd like to think of it more as an outlet, a source for me to be free in my own ways. So I don't go by the book on anything. As much as I appreciate and love other people's artwork, for me, just being able to express myself freely is really important. So my process specifically is just coming up with an idea, a sketch, and just using certain tools to make sure that it's scaled properly, compared like from the sketch to like a bigger format. This is one of my first murals. I think actually it was my first mural, so outdoor mural. So I ran into some issues regarding the weather and the time frame that I had. I don't know if the rest of you recall, but it was like snowy, it was like a little bit like rainy, those around that time. So it was pretty cool. I think trial and error is a big one. Obviously, like, we do our research regarding what will work, what kind of materials to use, and, you know, it's a lot that kind of goes into technically on a technical basis. But I think the actual doing it part, once you kind of get to do it, it's almost like if you're learning how to do something with like muscle memory, I guess you can say, you just kind of like get the swing of it, if that makes sense. So yeah.
How about our other artists we haven't heard from in terms of both the reactions you've received and also your process, if you'd like to talk about that? And Nyjah, I see you nodding. Does that mean you would like to comment on that?
Sure. I just wanted to make sure other people had a chance to speak first. I did get a really great response. A lot of people just kind of mentioning wanting to reconnect with their elders or like having that kind of relationship with the piece. And I kind of like that. I was able to kind of bring that to people. In terms of process, I'm a very sporadic kind of artist. So like I have like a sketch of like the basic idea I wanted to do, but I tend to make my sketches purposely pretty loose because I like to think that my finished product will be 10 times better. So I kind of just go with it. And like, I will say sometimes I have a pretty long process or a process that might seem to have unnecessary steps because I will just keep working on something or keep staying in the like acrylic and charcoal phase because I like to sketch with charcoal and then paint. I feel like it just makes it a better piece for me.
Okay, thank you.
So my process is the complete opposite of that. For me, it's all about planning. It's all about steps. It's all about being prepared, and especially working with the students right now. So I have 20 students painting 2,000 square feet of wall, simultaneously all their own designs. So for me, it's like I build the design, I draw it digitally, and actually I project. So I have a battery-powered projector I bring on location, and I transfer my sketch directly onto the wall. And when I show up the day of painting, I have all my colors mixed, I have all my everything. You know, for instance, the mural, this mural in Salem, I want to say actual time painting the wall, it probably only took me 3 hours, maybe 3.5 hours. just because I showed up, had everything, and just jumped right into it. So I can't paint on the fly like that. Well, there are some details and pattern work that goes in freehand. The bulk of it and the colors and the scheme is all planned out ahead of time, and it's something that I had to do with my students. So they did their designs. I went to the underpass at 10 o'clock at night, and I projected and traced all of their designs on the wall so that when they showed up, they only had to paint. And the high school was not keen on me having the kids meet at an underpass at 10 p.m.
Yeah.
So I did that section on my own.
I have a follow-up question, but as you guys all were talking about it, and of course the very nature of the call for art, but has it changed maybe because of the last year? We internally in the program, we have really, the very nature of our program is like social change through art, right? And you guys as artists and then working in the public realm, kind of like, has your responsibility changed or increased, or your perspective on what your responsibility is, on what story is being told through your art when you're working on public spaces? I mean, I can think of last year with like statues being taken down. And I remember Jacob mentioning, not right now, but in our previous conversation that we had, like the power of oral history versus written history and who carries that power. And as you guys are given a space and when you do your work, how do you battle, or how do you, I guess, balance those forces in your head when you're about to like make something so public, right? So I was just curious if there is no specific answer that I'm looking for, but more of like, kind of like your role as a speaker, because you're putting a piece that is going to last there for a long time. I remember, Anna, you did a piece to support the first responders in the Point neighborhood. So for good, always for the good, of course, but I mean, to sometimes for support, but then sometimes to highlight the unheard voices too, right? So I'm leaving the floor for anyone to talk about it.
So through the process of working with the kids, there's a lot of approval involved, right? We needed the town approval. Actually, Mass Department of Transit owns the bridge, so we need the bridge approval. The town has 10 different committees that manage outdoor recreation and bike path and blah, 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 blah. So I was kind of hired, brought on by the high school to help the students. So I was really caught between helping the students find their voice in their topic and having to explain to committees in the state why that's important. And it is funny because for me, public art so much needs to be about community and concept. You know, if a mural's pretty, but it doesn't necessarily have the community or conversation around it, it's not as important to me. I think we have an obligation as public artists to include the public. So for instance, the local paper wrote an article after it was approved at the town hall meeting. You know, group of high school students aims to make the rail trail pretty. And I was like, ooh, actually, you know, the goal of this project is to give the opportunity for students to express their artistic voices in a public way on a large scale, right? Has nothing to do with your ugly underpass that just happened to be there. So I did write the paper an email, and I did say, I did request that they write another article when this project is finished, that genuinely has the concept behind it. So I even told the Rail Trail Committee, I don't care if these come out beautiful. I was like, I care that every kid feels like they had the opportunity to express themselves visually in public and that they're happy with it. And I said, I will work with every student until they're happy with it. But those are my only responsibilities. I have no responsibilities to you. So it is about having kind of some hard conversations once in a while, and thinking about how you can do what's best for the community.
Okay, thank you, Jacob. Hey, Anna?
No, I'm like bringing back that. I'm like, he's got the teacher vibe going, so I'm like, I'll definitely. Yeah, so last year was definitely interesting. 2020, I think interesting is like the nicest word I can use for 2020, but I think if you didn't at least once have a deeper conversation with yourself throughout 2020, something's wrong with you. Like, and between the pandemic, between all of the social justice movements, between the civil rights movements, between all of these things happening, I think that it was more clear than ever that we all have a duty. We all have a purpose and we all have a role, right? And it's interesting because I don't think, even though I've always considered myself a creative person, I don't think until last year I truly understand what that meant as my role in society, right? So I think through last year, particularly with the Black Lives Matter movement, particularly with the social justice movements and the civil rights movements, it's been more clear than ever, like I said, that we all have a role. And as artists, and particularly as public artists, there is a sense of duty and a sense of responsibility to create spaces for conversations to be had, and to create spaces where undeniable truths are evident. So for instance, last year, you know, doing some chalk art for the thank you to healthcare workers. I worked on some Black Lives Matter chalk art as well. Like, there are just these things that we are communicators. That's really what artists are. And as public artists, it's our job to publicly communicate and publicly create spaces for conversations to be had. So I definitely think that we do have a sense of responsibility, but no more than anyone else. I think it's just that our role is inherently public. So I think we all have a duty to speak up. We all have a duty to use our talents for good, whether that be public art or that be, I don't know, an accountant. Like, we all have our role, right? So I definitely think that this past year has made it more evident than ever that public art is, one, important, and that it is powerful. And that is terrifying as a public artist, but it's also empowering. So, sorry if you can hear my dog.
David, I have a couple of like kind of meta questions for you, but before we go there, and maybe we can end on these, we have a number of questions here from the audience related to what comes next for each of these artists. Are you doing art elsewhere in Salem or elsewhere, you know, within the, you know, let's say North Shore, Boston, you know, area where people can go and see more of your work? We have shared your social media tags, but if there are things you're working on right now that you're particularly excited about and particularly things that people could go and see, what would those things be? And why don't I start with you, Jacob? And I'm only, by the way, when I pick the order you're in, it's the order you're appearing in my little boxes on my screen. So don't read any more into it than that.
Okay. So I have kind of a bunch of different murals planned for the summer. I have to finish the ones up with the kids. I have two scheduled for New Bedford, so South Coast, Massachusetts. Finished up a couple small ones in Brookline. So yeah, just kind of all over the place doing kind of what I need to do. I'll teach some private summer lessons, which I usually do. Yeah.
Okay, so, thank you.
And you have, we're doing installation of a couple of your prints, I believe, in Gloucester.
Yes, in Gloucester. I will also have work up in Gloucester as well.
On the new development that you just opened in Gloucester?
Yes.
Cool. Yeah. Nyjah, how about you? What's up next for you?
Sorry, I'm really bad with Zoom. Currently I'm going to be one of the residents at Mass MoCA's residency program. So currently I've just been working on a lot of personal projects that I have putting off for a couple of years and trying to get those out. And I'm also planning or doing a residency tour. So hopefully I'll be doing a lot of public art outside of Massachusetts in general. But that's kind of what I'm working on now.
Awesome. Thank you. Anna.
I'm kind of all over the place right now. I'm self-proclaiming myself as the queen of the Jersey barriers because
you have a lot of them.
Yeah. I have officially I've officially painted 50 Jersey barriers between last year and this year. I have 10 to go. But right now painting Jersey barriers currently in Chelsea, just did some in Danvers. I'm a finalist for a few larger scale murals, which will be pretty cool. It's weird as a public artist or as a freelance artist in general that sometimes projects can be so up in the air and you never know when they're gonna land. And 9 times out of 10, they always land at the exact same time. So that's always a little bit of a struggle, but a lot of fun things up ahead, a lot of fun things down the road. So yeah.
Thank you. And I'm not seeing Ambrosia on the screen. Are you still there? Maybe not. Okay, maybe we've lost Ambrosia.
Yeah.
David, I have a couple of questions, several questions for you actually from the audience. One is the direction for the retail space. Do you already have tenants planned for that retail space?
That's the incubator. So on Lafayette Street, it's about 500 square feet and we're partnering with small businesses and artists that if they reach out to our community engagement and program people, they can get 1 month for free the space. I think they have to cover maybe a small fee, like cleaning fee and insurance or something like that. But they can use the space as a retail space. I think we're booked for like the next 10 months starting in July.
Okay.
But we're happy to, so it will be like a rotating retail pop-up retail space on Lafayette Street that we're also letting the artists know that if you ever want to exhibit your work for a month, we do have a requirement that the shop has to be open for, I think, certain amount of hours a week to create some active street front, but yeah.
Okay. Another question for you is that during your introduction, and I think even on the Punto Urban website, you know, you talk about your mission being partly about connecting the Point neighborhood to the rest of Salem, of course, specifically to its adjacent neighbors, and also destigmatizing the Point neighborhood was also part of your mission. So curious about your reflections on, you know, how well you feel the projects are helping you hit those marks.
Well, it's a very philosophical question when we start about stigmatization. I mean, I will say it's a stigmatization of place because of systematic policies in housing back in 1930s where loans were not given to people of color has created neighborhoods where literally real estate by design went down in value. And so regardless of the people that live there, then of course you started segregating those neighborhoods and the people got stigmatized because of those policies. And then you start linking it to public schools financing and it's a whole self-perpetuating cycle of disinvestment in these immigrant communities. But as we talk of stigma, then where does stigma originate, right? And so many times what we try to do with this art program is almost also talk about like put a mirror on the people who visit as well, that everyone has a role to play on this. So how do we learn our role in society to be more inclusive? And so is it solved? No, but we have made great progress. I think one thing, for example, as people were like thinking of the stigmatizing was, well, we will rebrand the name of the neighborhood to Lola because it's Lower Lafayette. And one thing that we really made on purpose was to put Punto in Spanish because other people will call it the Point. at the very front of the art initiative. So everyone who visits says, start recognizing the Spanish heritage there. And then as we do installation of murals many times, we do community events, we start creating awareness. We do educational tours about learning about the immigrant story. If we are truly, which I mean, it's a conflicting story of this is a nation of immigrants, but of course the towards the Native American, it was brutality what happened there. So how do we reckon with that tough history and move on being more inclusive? So in certain areas we have succeeded and in others we still have a lot more to work, but I think it's because the nature of the problem is very complex, but we have found through art that we can build as many housing, we can renovate the many parks, but those social issues that come from generations of discrimination towards minorities, art might be the best vehicle to start talking about it, and it will take generations to fix it, but we're working towards that and we're creating awareness, which is the most important thing.
Now, I know this may be a little different because we're just coming out of the pandemic, but if people want to come and learn more about the murals and see the murals in person, I know you used to do walking tours. Are you still doing that, or are there other mechanisms through which people can engage with your organization and learn more about
them? Yes. So we have a webpage, puntourbanartmuseum.org and northshorecdc.org. Tours, we're starting them again, hopefully later this summer. Our office is still closed because of COVID, but we do tours for 20 plus people. And then we also have a mobile app that has every mural that it's in the museum, and it links to the information about the mural. So it shows you where you are. It's kind of like Google Maps. And then you can click and see all the murals and where you are. So that will be the best route right now. You can also download a map on our webpage that it shows also every mural there. And I will encourage everyone to also visit the amazing restaurants that we have. They're mostly immigrant owned and they have delicious food. Dominicans and Diaz, Mediterranean. So I totally, as you visit the murals, please experience the full, beautiful community that is there, so.
Well, we promised you that we would honor your hard stop at 8 o'clock. We're 7:59 according to my watch. I wanna thank David and Jacob and Nijah and Anna and Ambrosia for joining us tonight. This was really wonderful. I have personally enjoyed your work and all of the murals in the Point over and over again. So I wish I could do what you folks do. I think a lot of people do. And it is just so, so beautiful and inspiring. And it just makes you happy to walk through there. So thank you for that gift that you have given our community. Thank you to everybody who joined us tonight for our program. Carolyn's been posting social media tags for the artists and for Punto Urban. They're in the chat. We have recorded this session, so it will be available if you want to share it, you want to see it again or share it with friends after tonight. Also want to remind people that we have a couple of great programs coming up in June. Next week on the 17th, Lauren Aguirre is speaking about her book, The Memory Thief, which is a true story of the team of doctors who discovered a surprising connection between opioids and memory. And on June 24th, we'll be joined by Doreen Wade. She's the president of Salem United, the organization that runs the Black Picnic every year, not last year, but Doreen currently has an exhibit in Hamilton Hall, and we'll be speaking about the exhibit and the history of Black self-governance in the United States when she speaks with us on June 24th. So thank you to everybody who joined us tonight. We're so grateful for your support, and thank you again to our fabulous artists. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for hosting us.